sore, or because we have bruises, it's because we like to give bruises to the devil. Give bruises to Satan and not allow him to get into us. And we may not be the biggest and we may not be the best choir, but we have fun doing it. And the major thing we want to do is minister. That's what we're here in front of you tonight to do, is to minister to you and to touch your heart through the Holy Spirit working through us. So just allow him to do that. Our first song tonight is called I Was Glad.
There's a call. People aren't going to know you're a Christian. Listen, in this day and age, you can't afford to turn people off. You got to mix in. You've got to identify. You can't leave me on sign flashing Christian, Christian, Christian. You got to flash subtle. 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 There. That's better. And how many Christians do you still see carrying around this big Bible? If you've got it for scripture, try something a little smaller. An edited scripture. Just the important verses. There. Now you look like the rest of us. What do you look so confused about? Christ commanded us to go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. To fulfill this task, the confidence we have is through Christ toward God, not that we are adequate in ourselves to consider anything as coming from ourselves, but our adequacy is from God. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things passed away, behold, all things become new. Therefore, we are all Christ's ambassadors.
you have your Bibles tonight? If you could open up to Matthew chapter 6, starting with verse 25. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more important than food, and the body more important than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Who of you, by worrying, can add a single hour to his life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the lilies of the field grow? They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. And that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire. Will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. And I think there's a lot of wisdom in this book. And that passage right there, so many times we get caught up in our worries that we forget what we are here to do. We lose our focus. We are here to serve God. We're God's vessels for him to work through. And we get so bogged down with our worries and something, we forget that we are, as this next song says, we are destined to win. There's a higher place that we're searching for. There's a place that is on the other side of the hill. Just when we think that we're going to be down in the dumps and we'll never make it, there is. The sun rises up in the morning. And go ahead and start this song. As we sing this song, just be challenged. Just be challenged to know that we are destined to win.
This song.
both these trials, God stands strong. We've got to be bold for Him. Because Satan is going to be trying everything in his power to begin you guys down spiritually and physically. And that's why prayer and fasting will not only get rid of this trial, but we'll also benefit from it. The song I'm going to sing is I Won't Turn Back. And I pray that these words will encourage your heart to stay strong in Him.
Oh, Good evening. Abaddon, accuser, adversary, angel of the abyss, Apollyon, devil, god of this age, prince of this world, ruler of darkness, serpent, tempter, unclean spirit, evil one. These all describe Satan. And the next thing that we're going to do is a skit. And it's called Satan Bite the Dust. I got to play another thing. This is real hard. And Apollyon. These are my nods. All those names describe Satan. Those weren't even all of them. There's probably about 10 more of them. But we all know there's a song that says, Satan, the blood of Jesus is against you. And that is so true. Jesus died upon the cross, and he shed his blood so that we would have the power to cast out these evil things, such as the spirit of alcoholism, the spirit of depression, the spirit of anger, the spirit of fear, all those things that, you know, come inside of us and just literally try to destroy us. In this skit, it talks about the spirit of depression and strife, disease, and it goes and shows how that we can get rid of these and how that we have the power over these things. I think we need to start getting down and dirty with Satan. Amen? I mean, a lot of us Christians anymore, and Steve brought this out one time, and it really stuck in my mind. A lot of us Christians, when we go in our prayer closets or something, we pray like this, you know, against Satan. Oh, Lord, we bind Satan in the name of Jesus. Satan, we command you to... I don't think we need to start doing that. I think we need to say, Satan, we command you in the name of Jesus to get out of here. We command you in the name of Jesus to flee. We command the spirit of depression to be loosed in the name of Jesus. I think that's how we're going to start preaching. That's how we're going to start living our lives. That's how we're going to start praying in our prayer closets. Amen? This skit is a great skit, and I think our kids do an excellent job. So, when you're watching the skit, think of the thing that's in your heart. Is it something that's in your life? Fear or depression or strife or whatever it may be. And tell Satan just to get out of here. This evening I believe that everyone can be free from whatever it is that they're struggling with. Smoking, I believe that Jesus can deliver you from smoking this evening. Whatever it is, I don't care. It says right there, Satan, the blood of Jesus is against you. The blood he shed upon that cross 2,000 years ago is against Satan. Amen.
Sick. That's it. Now what's wrong with you, you drunk? question from Jeremy. I'm not going to go without board. Okay, you guys know the format when I preach. Instead of just having a few, we're having an entire amen section now. Okay, here we go. Hands, everybody, here we go. Jesus is Lord.
Amen.
He reigns above all. You turn with me in Colossians chapter 3, verse 23. It says, "And whatsoever ye do, do it heartily, as to the Lord, and not unto men." I think one of the greatest problems facing our churches today is our lack of intensity in what we're doing. What the Lord has given me tonight is probably one of the hardest things I've had to struggle to get from the Lord to speak. I've known for about a week that Pastor Steve wanted me to get up and share for a few minutes. And, a few minutes, I didn't think, oh, no, wait, yeah, I'm going to say a few words, but this was really difficult. I've had an entire day, an entire week to work on this, and up until the prayer meeting before the service, I was totally at a loss for what the Lord wanted me to say tonight. But I feel like the Lord is saying that our time is so short. And Romans said, in that knowing the time, that it is high time to awake out of sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than when we believe. Our redemption is drawing nigh, and because of that, we need to have a renewed intensity in all that we do for the kingdom of God. We've got to do it to the Lord and not to men. We've got to stop worrying about getting rewards from men and having pride and getting our ego and pats on the back. We've got to start doing it because we want to do it for the Lord and because our time is so short. We need intensity in our prayer life. When we get down on our knees to seek God to move on behalf of our church and on behalf of our nation and on behalf of our world for the lost and the dying, we have to have intensity when we do it. If we get down in a lackadaisical attitude on our knees, God is not going to respect that. We've got to get down and wrestle with the Lord and agonize in prayer to get what we need from the Lord. We need intensity in our love and our compassion. So many times we become so removed from the people that really need love and compassion. As the lepers in the Bible, they were secluded. They were moved away. They were alienated. Nobody was to go near them. And there's so many people in our society today that are like the lepers. Because of things that they've done, because of the way they are, they've alienated themselves, and we, the church, have alienated them from us. It's time that we start having an intensity in our compassion for the lost. Where's our compassion gone? The compassion that the Lord saw when he looked over the sea and he said Jesus wept because he felt compassion on them. We need intensity again that will cause us to go out and share the message that we have. And we need to share it with intensity. If we truly want to revive, if we truly want to move into the Spirit like we say that we want, we've got to have a renewed intensity in all that we do. Because there are so many that do not know. And there are so many that need to hear. And how are we supposed to be? It says that ye may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God without rebuke in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation, among whom ye shine as lights in the world, holding forth the word of life. That is the call given to us. Shine as lights in the world, holding forth the word of life. We need to renew our intensity, renew our desire because our time is short. Renew it and hold forth that word of life. And shine in that light as God has told us to do in this nation and the time that we're living. Because then we can revive, and then we can be a church that is on the move and effectively working for the kingdom of God. Amen. Develop an intensity in your prayer life. Develop an intensity in your compassion. Develop an intensity in your study of the word. And then we can see God move as he wants to move in our midst.
Amen. Praise the Lord. I'd like us to stand. I want the musicians to come. It'd be nice to give these guys some more time to preach. Amen. Be here on Wednesday night and the coming Wednesday night, since we'll get an opportunity to hear them.
Praise the Lord.
You know, I'm excited about what God's doing in our young people at Calvary. How many are you excited about the Spirit of God? We don't just have a youth group that's just status quo. We've got a group of young people that are filled, I believe, with the present day anointing of the Holy Ghost. As the song says, we're a new breed of Christians for today. And I think we've got a lot of this type of breed, and we praise God for that. We need that. We live in this hour that's coming short to the end of times, and we need to have that intensity. Brother Bob is preaching about. We need to have an anointing upon our life that sends us forth, that makes a difference in our life. Most of us, I think the youth can join with me in saying that they are third or fourth generation Pentecostals. Many of our youth group, I think, can say that. Perhaps some of them can say the fifth generation. You know what that says to me? It says one thing. It says that our responsibility is greater than those that were before us. How do you believe that? If you're a third or a fourth generation, it says simply the fact that our time is closer to the return of the Lord than what it was when my great-grandparents preached the Word of God out in Hot Springs and in Fort Smith and in Van Buren, in Arkansas. I thank God for the heritage that many of us have, but our responsibility is greater than the hour. They tell me that any time in any sport or any competition, that the most important moments are the last seconds of a ball game, the last seconds of the fourth quarter. When I played basketball in school, and you look at me, I did play basketball, believe it or not. They always told us that the most crucial moments were the fourth quarter. And I remember the coach had the privilege one year of playing on an undefeated team. And I believe that one of the reasons why the team was undefeated was because our coach pushed us from the beginning of the year in Panama City. We ran around the track. We got on the football field in the hot 100-degree weather. And we ran and we ran and we ran and we ran. And he told us one thing. He said, you may not be the best shooters. You may not be the greatest athletes. You may not be the most talented. But one thing you're going to be is the greatest conditioned team. And that's what will bring you forth as victors in the fourth quarter of those games. And I remember that. That made a difference in our life. And folks, if you don't understand what I'm saying to you spiritually, you need to wake up and realize the message is true. We have a responsibility and an urgency about being alive and on fire for God. And I want to see that in every single individual of Calvary Assembly. I believe that God has not called us moms and dads to just ride the coattail out until the trumpet sounds. I don't believe that there's an individual in this room tonight that your responsibility and your job as a soldier of God is over. You Paul told Timothy in 2 Timothy, thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier. No man that warreth entangles himself with the affairs of this life, but he lives to please him that has chosen him to be a soldier. And I believe that God has called every one of us to be soldiers, and our job is not done, folks. We're not in retirement. It's not over. We have not turned in our pink slip yet. We are still on the firing line. When God is through with you, he'll call you home. And I believe with all my heart that God wants to use us effectively and empoweredly in these last seconds of time, in this fourth quarter of our existence of the human race. And I want to do something tonight. I felt impressed to do during the worship time tonight. I'm going to ask just a moment for all of the youth choir to come. You know, these kids have been praying, they've been seeking God, they've been, a lot of them are fasting. A lot of them are just fasting for seeking God for his will. A number of them, they'll call them to ministry. Incidentally, we have 16 of our young people that are going to either be at Central Bible College or at Evangel College coming this fall. I think that's tremendous. We've got some 20 young people in this youth group that fill a full-time call of God, their life into the ministry. And, you know, James says that we can use our own hands to pray for one another. He said to confess your faults to one another and to pray for one another that you may be healed. He says the fervent, effectual prayer of a righteous man availeth much. And I believe God can use these young people. What I want to do, I want to have them come and line up across the front. And I'm going to give an invitation tonight for those that have some area in your life where you would like one of the family of God to lay hands and join with you in prayer against Satan. Maybe it be a financial need, maybe it be a physical need, maybe you have a spiritual need. If you need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit,